Good afternoon.
Yeah, excited? Last day. Thursday. I wish it was the last day, though.
4 days.
How's the conference? Good? Good? Yeah.
Did you watch the debate?
Yes, Monday evening. It was fun, right? Yeah, it was. All right, so, you know, here we are, Thursday, last session of the day. Want to talk about data and analytics and how it would help us to elect the next president, right? Or our vote would elect it. I don't care about data. Anyway, so I am Ashish Jaiman, and with me I have Ethan Chumley.
Hi, everyone.
And we are in this team in Microsoft called Campaign Tech and Services. A very interesting team. 2 years back, we were formed to help the ecosystem, the campaign ecosystem, the campaigns, the committees, the vendor ecosystem, and help them to understand the value of Microsoft Cloud Platform, specifically data and analytics, and how they can use it. We all know data is everywhere, right? And back in 2008, 2012, you know, that became the story of elections, right? How Obama used data and analytics to, you know, win his campaign or win the White House. And, you know, even in enterprises today, you know, we can't have a conversation without having the M word, right? The machine learning word. If you don't know about machine learning, then people say you may not even know anything, right? This is a crazy world we live in, right? But anyways, the whole point of data is, and as we have seen in the last couple of years, is tremendous amount of data every day, tremendous amount of data. And it's very hard to make sense of that data. And the perfect use case in today's world and in this cycle is the elections, right? As we see, I don't know if you realize, you know, the voter file itself, which is publicly available, by the way, you know, if you want to actually go and do some work to get the voter file from the state and department of election or something, right? 290 million records there, right? I don't know how many columns, multi-terabytes of data to make sense of it. And that's what we were trying to do is we want to work with the campaigns, work with the committees and the vendor ecosystem, help them understand what Microsoft Azure data and analytics platform can do for them. And that was our goal. So, you know, we know, you know, we are the world's biggest software company. We have a ton of data and analytics tools, platforms, solutions. But you know, how does it apply to this ecosystem, right? One of the things about this ecosystem, by the way, if you haven't realized it yet, it is very partisan, right? There are two arms, they don't talk to each other. There are two sides, we don't want to talk to each other, they don't want to share the learning. So, you know, if R is doing something cool, they don't want D to know, and vice versa. It was a challenge for us, too. How do we, Microsoft, go into this ecosystem and be a non-partisan or a bipartisan, you know, vendor? So one of the things that was our key learning is, to get into this ecosystem, we have to have two sets of teams, right? Which actually we do because, you know, hey, we sell to Coke and Pepsi, right? We do business with GM and Ford and whatever, right? So what we did is we had two sets of technical evangelists and domain experts, and we said, all right, you know, you are the one who would actually work on the solution side. Then there will be a team of technical folks that would help you, right? So when we talk, when I talk, I'm talking platform and technology. When Ethan talks to the D side, he talks about strategy and what D Democrats can do. And then I have another team member, Joel, who talks to the R side, right? And that's how we formed the company. That was our key learning. We have the best of the world analytics platform. So we actually thought, you know, why not bring everything together and help the ecosystem? I just want to quickly give you an overview of the ecosystem. I'm sure you all know it. But on the left, your left, right, is the Progressive campaign, right? We all know Clinton is the nominee, Tim Kaine is VP choice. One of the key things there is the vendor ecosystem, right? DNC, the Democratic National Committee, their role is to be the technical and solution provider for a campaign, right? So they have digital experts, they have data experts, they have technology experts that would help the campaign. So, you know, it was for us to actually work with DNC so that they can start looking at Azure and see how it can help them. Then the vendor ecosystem, one of the biggest progressive vendor is NGP WAN. And we are fortunate that the CTO of NGP WAN is here, and he will share his experience working with Microsoft and the things that they have done on our platform. And then there are vendors like Target Smart, which is the data vendor. Now, I did say that the voter file is available to anyone, right? But the value add that any data vendor would do in this ecosystem is to augment that voter file with many attributes that would help a campaign to micro-target a voter, right? So if they want to talk to Ashish, you know, what Target Smart does is it actually adds not only demographic information, but household information, financial information, and whatever they can get either from a public data feed somewhere or private data feed that they actually can buy, right? They augment this voter file and make it so that a campaign can micro-target me for two things. One is to get my vote or to get money from me, right? Because the campaigns run on money as well, as you know. On the right, we have Trump and Pence. RNC, so we worked with RNC as well. As I shared, you know, Joel worked with RNC very closely. There's a vendor called CCG, Convergence Consulting Group. We have James McAuliffe from CCG here. He'll also share his learnings, how he use Microsoft platform. Vendors like CMDI, DataTrust, they also help the ecosystem with data and analytics. So that's the campaign landscape. Let me quickly talk about the structure. So it's all about people, by the way. Yes, campaign, you know, has a limited staff, but a lot of volunteers. That gives another challenge, and we'll talk about the challenges that campaign faces. So, you know, campaign has to have a mechanism to manage all those people. There are internal comms and devices issues, right? Which is, you know, these volunteers may bring their own device. How do you manage those devices once you are in the in the campaign headquarters, right? Or in that sandbox of campaign? There are issues not only about the device but the data on the device. Right, because as I said, you know, you don't want any of the data to be shared by the other side. It's a very rigid finance and compliance framework that a campaign works in. Right, you know, we all know about FEC. You know, they provide very strict guidelines on how and what an individual can contribute to a campaign, but how the campaign is managing that money. Right, so you can't. And then there are other laws as well, right? You know, email laws and whatnot, right? How can they target and whatnot? There's a whole infrastructure for polling in a campaign, polling and testing, focus groups, you know, so that they can figure out how to tweak the message in the next time a candidate speaks, right? So that's a big part of a campaign. But what we want to focus on are the three highlighted things in there, which is data management. So how do you manage voter file data? Not just voter file data, but finance data. How do you manage volunteer data, the field data, the staff data? And you know, how Azure plays into that. We also want to talk about the voter file itself, right? Voter file is huge, right? Sparse as well, because not everyone's information or all the columns are there, right? So it's a sparse, big data set that we have to work with, and a lot of analytics, right? Lot of analytics. When I say analytics, it's all about machine learning. It's all about algorithms and how. What is your propensity to vote, right? Would you be able to, you know, when I ask you for X amount of, you know, hours to volunteer or X, you know, amount of dollars, would you actually give me that? Right, so there's a lot of data analytics that goes behind the scenes, and even the testing, email testing, right? If I put out this message in the email and ask for a donation, would you be clicking on that email versus if the message was a bit different, right? So there's a lot goes on. I want to actually talk about the challenges, and this is the one of the interesting things that we learned in this space was a presidential campaign or any campaign actually is very much like a startup, right? All kinds of startup issues, limited funding, right? Well, even if they have money, you know, tech and data digital operations are kind of one of the lower budget items in that that mindset of campaigns. So limited amount of money, staffing requirements, right? You know, you have limited staff, but a lot of volunteers, which poses its own challenges. There's a deadline to work towards, and that deadline is not shifting, right? There's an election day, yes. There are debates, yes, and they are firmly planned for, right? So you know, you may not gain momentum, but there's a deadline you have to actually release your product on, or you know, you have to work for. So that's a big challenge. The other thing is rapid scale up, right? You know, all of a sudden, you know, you start getting traction. You have to not only hire more people, but you need more money. You have to quickly set up that infrastructure. And even more interestingly is even faster scale down, right? If anything goes wrong, after the election, you have to scale down like the next day, tear all the infrastructure up, or if you decide, you know, to quit the race, right? Whatever the thing is, the day off, you have to tear the infrastructure down, which is a unique challenge, especially it works out in a cloud infrastructure. You know, cloud is, I think one of the best use cases to use cloud is campaign business, right? Just because, you know, you quickly scale and then you can tear it down. We talked about data, a huge amount of data. We talk about big data, but you know, this is where you would see the real big data and how you can work with that data. A lot of analytics needs, as we already shared. Regulation and compliance, that's another unique challenge, not only for the campaigns, but the vendors who work with the campaigns, right? What can you do with the campaigns and what you can't, right? You know, a simple example is if I am giving my service to a campaign, it may be construed as a kind donation from Microsoft, right? So I can't do anything for free for a campaign, right? So those are unique challenges for the vendor, but also for campaigns on how do they actually put that in perspective of the contributions, the money, who they can email, who they can target, and whatnot. Volunteer staff management, big challenge because most of the ecosystem actually runs on volunteers. Most of the campaigns run on volunteer. The mobility is another one, right? Because as I was saying, you end up bringing your own devices. So the challenge is to have the software and whatever mechanisms you have to do canvassing and mobilization on those devices. But how do you manage that? How do you not only manage the device, but the data? Right, and quickly scale that up. Right, if I am a presidential campaign and I go to a battleground, I realize, hey, this is now turning purple, right, from red to blue or blue to red, right? As I need to scale up quickly, I need to hire a lot of people, I have to move all my infrastructure there. It's a big challenge, right? Mobility, not only of the staff, but data and tools and everything, and security, right? Huge issue. I'm sure you hear it about all the time, but you know, you have to secure everything, not only the data, but the devices, and everything, right? Security is a big aspect of the campaign. Now, with all that said, right, I think, and this is what we actually started up 2 years ago to do is prove out that Azure can help to elevate all these challenges, help them actually for these challenges, right? You know, if you have to quickly scale up, you can actually very easily on Azure. If you have to scale down, you can just turn off Azure, right? Or turn off your instance of Azure. Big data, yes, we have all the innovations. I'm sure you've heard about this in this conference. You know, data lake analytics, data lake, Hadoop, SQL Server data warehouse, a lot that we can offer in the cloud. On analytics, you know, that is the theme of this conference, I guess, the AI part, right? You know, we have not just analytics from ML and data lake analytics, but the cognitive APIs, right? Which is, you know, we even remove the need of a data scientist, right? From the, if you want to do something very cool with analytics. Regulation compliance, security, you know, again, you know, actually, this is a great thing that we can say that, hey, any other infrastructure versus if you compare Azure on security, we work out to be better on security. Mobility, you know, again, you can manage devices using our cloud infrastructure. You can manage devices. So with all that, you know, what we want to share next is the things that we did in the ecosystem, right? So think of this talk is a chalk talk where we are sharing how we did it and why we did it. Right, but how we did it interestingly from our side, but also some vendors and partners who actually helped us in this journey. So, Ethan?
Great, thanks, Shish. So there's two parts of the campaign story that Microsoft sought to undertake when we started doing this. One is exactly what Ashish was saying, the data, the analytics, helping the campaigns run. But the other side of this is the civic engagement part. Our team is tech and civic engagement, and we are looking to improve the civic process. And as a lot of you know, the first major event after some of the primaries that occur, or rather before the primaries, is the Iowa caucuses. And first off, is anyone in here from Iowa? Just show of hands. Yeah, have you voted in a caucus before? No. The Iowa caucuses are a unique animal. Primary voting, for those not from the US, there are many presidential candidates, and ultimately there is one on each side. And the process of whittling those down is a primary vote. You think of voting as walking into a booth, filling out a piece of paper, dropping it in a box, it gets counted. The caucuses in Iowa are an animal of their own in that on the Republican side, it works similarly. Everyone in a precinct gathers in a room. Some rooms are this size, some are larger, some are smaller. Representatives from the candidates give speeches. People write on a piece of paper what they want. They turn it in, and it's counted. The Democrats have this insane process of physically putting themselves in places in the room if they want to cast a vote. So if you wanted to vote for Hillary, you would stand here. And if you wanted Bernie, you would stand here. And then we would count, and you can actually persuade people and like physically move them from one side of the room to the other. It's nuts. And it's the first. It's the first primary. It's a crazy system. It gets a lot of attention. And we have a quick video to sort of explain sort of what Microsoft was doing at the conventions, and then I'll talk through it in a little bit more detail. But we saw this process of, first off, an insane voting system, but secondly, when it was done at each precinct, there would be a precinct captain that would say, this many people voted for these number of candidates. They would then take that piece of paper and at their leisure in the next 72 hours, drive it to the county clerk's office and hand it to the county clerk, with the entire world watching while they got stuck in rush hour traffic, delivering a piece of paper to the county clerk's office to count a vote. There was some room for improvement. And that's sort of what we started to do. Let me see if I can roll this video here.
The Iowa caucuses are precinct level meetings of neighbors to talk about politics, to talk about the future of the parties. We've been doing those since the 1850s, 1860s. The Iowa Democratic Party, the Iowa Republican Party started working with Microsoft about a year ago to develop a reporting mechanism to bring us into the current day.
This is a way that we knew we could engage a new, younger, millennial generation, and we clearly were able to do that.
We actually built 12 apps, 6 for each party, iOS, Android, and Windows, phone and tablet. It's a transformation for everybody to digitize that human workflow that they had.
There were years where we never got all of our precincts in, and we had 100% of our precincts in before midnight, which is incredible.
And we've provided an API that allows the media and the campaigns to take a look at this data and pull it themselves into their own experiences.
There are media here from all over the world, so we sponsor the Media Center.
We provide them power, we provide them their stand-up locations, all of the facilities they need to run a professional news organization.
Thanks again to the folks at Microsoft and Skype for having us here. Can I get out of the way here and just sort of show? I mean, look at what's going on here.
Thanks to our partnership with Microsoft, We are first in technology.
We're actually involved in a lot of different ways across the company,
from the research organization to the Skype team to the Bing Elections team
to the Microsoft Pulse team.
So we're bringing One Microsoft together to be as supportive as we possibly can for both sides of the aisle.
We're melding a 100-year-old process with modern technology. That's always an interesting dance.
We're really committed to understanding this and then figuring out how to scale this around the world.
So that was sort of the high level of what we did. And I guess sort of to start, as you might have noticed in that video, both the Iowa Democratic and Republican parties partook in this process. And they both had the same objective in mind. I assume that probably everyone in the room before has worked on a project where maybe two stakeholders in the project occasionally disagreed with each other, and this was no different, but sometimes in a much larger scale. But we really tried to focus here on, as Dan said in the video, fixing a 100-year-old process and bringing it into the modern day and digitizing that. So how did we do that? We had a precinct reporting app, like we actually had 12, one for each platform, one for the Democrats, one for the Republicans. And if you were a precinct captain, you would go into your app store and you would download the Iowa Caucus Reporting app. We had a lot of security behind this. We didn't want other people calling in precinct results for precincts that they should not have been, and there was an authentication mechanism. And all of this also to say that sometimes the most wonderfully intentioned, civically minded people are not necessarily those that know how to use their smartphones the best. It's just the case. So you will notice from these screenshots that there are not a lot of options. There are not a lot of bells and whistles. There's no settings menu, right? There are big numbers and big buttons, and you only have one choice, go forward, or I guess the second choice is go backwards. And we really put a lot of thought into this, into the UI of the application, right? An 84-year-old who has just got her first smartphone needs to be able to know how to use this as well as, you know, any millennial or anyone that is particularly good with technology. So you know, we had a lot of training and development, but as with a lot of things in politics also, moved a little slowly. So there was maybe a little bit of a rush at the end. These dates aren't moving. So we got to experience sort of the back half of a development life cycle in the span of about 10 days. After the code shipped, we had to train everyone, fix bugs, push it out, retrain. So that was quite a process. We spent quite a bit of time in Iowa teaching people how to make this app, or how to use the app, excuse me. But ultimately, it ended up being very successful, very straightforward, simple and easy to use, and that was a lesson that I learned, certainly, is to really consider the user base when developing an application much more than some of the nice features we would have liked to see. The most important thing was that it worked. After the 1,700 precinct captains spread across Iowa submitted their results, those results went through a little bit of a logic engine. Those results were received by some of the rules engines that we had in Azure. And the thought was, if this result seemed reasonable, we would go ahead and accept it as a valid result and post it through that API so that the Associated Press and some other stakeholders could ingest that information and it would be considered valid. But then there were some rules that maybe we needed a person to look at. Like I said, we were moving quickly on this project and didn't have time to program for every edge case, which is often the case in most projects. So we decided to make every edge case, we bundled up what we thought were edge cases and kicked them to the best computer we had in the room, which was the Iowa Democratic Party employees who were sitting there at their tablets waiting for, if you see that number 8 requires validation, there are 8 of these results that, hey, something looks a little off. You'd click on that, you'd see this second screen on the bottom right, which was some information about the precinct and why it didn't pass our rules. For example, more people voted in this precinct than have ever voted in the past, in history. That might be a reason to raise a yellow flag and get somebody to look at it, right? Somebody looks at it, they approve it, they say, oh yeah, that's fine, it's just high turnout. We were expecting high turnout. The Bernie Sanders, Hillary Clinton debate or whatever it was generated a lot of interest. Sure, that's fine. Or no, it's not fine, let me invalidate this result, call the precinct captain, and incorporate some of that tried and true process. and sort of back out of our application when needed. And then ultimately, like you heard Chad say in the video, Chad is the Republican Party of Iowa chair. All of the results were released by midnight. In the past, it had taken sometimes 3 full days to get all of the results in. Sometimes there was always one precinct missing. But in this case, we got all of the results in a couple hours, which was really amazing. The big onus behind this project and the reason that the parties, both of them in Iowa, reached out to us, I'm not sure if anyone remembers the Mitt Romney, Rick Santorum primary last year in 2012. There was some rudimentary reporting that declared one candidate the winner. And he stood up there and he made his acceptance speech. And then 3 days later, when everyone finally drove their pieces of paper to the county clerk's office, he had actually lost. And that was a big debacle, and they didn't want that to happen again, and it didn't happen again. So that was the Iowa caucuses, right? The civic improvement part of that. And sort of the next major spectacle in politics is the conventions. So after all of these primaries have occurred, again, for those not too familiar with US politics, once a primary season has whittled down to one candidate on each side, each one of these candidates has a convention. The RNC, the Republican National Convention, and the DNC, the Democratic National Convention, which are equal parts pep rally, political meetings, and media spectacle. And if you watch any of this on the news, you probably might agree with that three-part sentiment. But Microsoft was very heavily involved in both conventions. We thought it was sort of important to represent both of the parties there and to show our support. And we have another little video here that will show you some of the things that we did at the conventions.
In 2016, Microsoft worked with both political parties here at the conventions. We've been doing this for the last 4 political cycles, so we have a really strong history of working on a bipartisan basis to smooth the democratic process in operation.
Microsoft's doing a lot at the national conventions this cycle.
They've been involved with the conventions for a long time, helping on all of our back-end infrastructure, the servers. We use CRM, you know, that helped us basically run our entire volunteer program.
One of the major things is mobility. We equipped all of our staff with Surface devices this cycle, which was a big change from previous cycles.
The conventions are like a small business, so we've done a great deal of work to provide them everything that a small business would need. And then at the conventions themselves, we're doing additional work to help them put on the actual show.
We've been working with the RNC and DNC to integrate Skype into the technical solutions at both conventions.
We have live TX integrations with our partnership with AP.
We spoke to the DNC as well. What they really wanted to do here was get Skype callers for their viewing parties around the US into the main stage to talk to one of their speakers on the last day.
This is essentially a major live TV production over 4 days.
We've been very busy at the Democratic National Convention. By the end of this event, we'll have reached about 2 million viewers.
We're very excited to be a part of this. It's a chance to showcase our technology as well as connect viewers with the democratic process.
We're also doing some public engagement. We've had thousands of people walking through the Politico Hub space. It's been pretty exciting to see people experiencing the great things that Microsoft does. In Cleveland, we have an app that will help the Visitors Bureau in the future.
We partnered to actually do a mobile platform. The anchors of the community all got together, and it's really a platform to launch what we do in new technologies hosted on Azure.
And we're really excited in Philadelphia. We're opening the Microsoft Reactor there.
We hope the Reactor has sustaining value to our community, and that years from now, their interest in technology will come from what is done here in the Reactor.
Underlying all of this is a way of getting people to be engaged in the process.
We're really proud of what we've done in the last 4 political cycles. We're here today, but we're going to be here again in the future, engaging in the democratic process.
All right. So like Ashish was saying earlier, a campaign is a lot like a startup, and you can think of the conventions as a startup within that startup. The conventions exist only for the purpose, the convention organizing committees exist only for the purpose of hosting the convention, and then they go away. They hire thousands of staff and volunteers. They need to manage an incredible amount of logistics, and we help them with Office 365 for collaboration. The Republicans did all of their volunteer management in Dynamics. So instead of doing case management, they used those same templates but applied them to assigning volunteers to different parts of the convention center, the city, broadly. And then we tried to leave something behind as well. One of the big criticisms of the conventions is that you get 70,000 people that descend upon a city, they take it for what it's worth, and then everyone goes home. So we tried to leave a little bit behind while we were there. The Republican convention, we had a citizen service app. Citizens could report streetlights, potholes, et cetera, that were, you know, just general concerns around the city that would get fed right back into the city government. The Democratic National Convention, we had very similar involvement there. We had lots of Skype work. We had the back-end infrastructure. We streamed the acceptance speeches, actually all of the recorded televised content. We streamed through demconvention.com, which was the official website of the convention, which was hosted in Azure, which I also think, I'm not 100% on this statement, but I think it's the largest WordPress implementation that's ever existed within Azure. Their entire website was run on WordPress. We saw about 2.3 million unique viewers over the course of 4 days. And at its peak, we were serving video content to 330,000 people concurrently. And that was all running, all while, as you might imagine, needing to be rather secured and hardened, as some political targets have been security targets also this cycle. So that was our involvement in the conventions. Ashish, you want to come up here and talk about some of our polling Pulse. And engagement technology? Yeah, there you go.
So you guys know about Pulse, Microsoft Pulse? No? Oh, man, this is the best social engagement tool from Microsoft. Right? It's a second screen audience engagement tool. When I say second screen, the idea is pretty simple. So if you are watching something either live or on demand, what we do typically is we actually start using our screen to monitor Twitter and Facebook. Like, and most of us did it during debate on Friday, on Monday. What Pulse gives you an ability to create your own polling and voting on top of that media, right? What I mean by that is, for a focus group like MSNBC or Fox News or whoever, actually the media groups actually do focus groups as the debate is going on. They'd have people and they would actually do thumbs up, thumbs down as the candidate is talking about a point. A Pulse allows you to do that. So you can create online surveys, you can create polling, voting, and everything else very easily, right? And then lay it over on top of that video, right? So that you can get the second, not only second screen engagement, but also monitor the reaction of real people on that video or on that stream. You know, Pulse in 2016 elections, you know, as you see here, you know, CNN uses it, right, a lot. State of the Union, actually, Pulse was used in State of the Union so that users at home who are watching CNN can do thumbs down and thumbs up, and then CNN can gather all that data and then do reporting, and maybe next day it becomes a story for the next day, right? So that's the whole idea. One of the other things that I want to call out is, I'm sure you've watched all debates, you watch on TV, but you could have also watched on watchthedebates.org. You know, we not only have the debates streamed, but you can actually go back to what, 40 years?
1960.
1960. Yeah. So you can watch all the debates there. And I think you can do Pulse on top of those debates too, right? Even though they are historic, but you can still see, you know, how you feel about what Reagan may have said, right? And all that. So we have this pretty cool website which we launched last week. mm-hmm. right? Earlier this week, actually, during the debate, just prior to the debate, watchthedebate.org. With that, what I want to do is, actually, we talked about a lot about the data and analytics and everything. What we have tried to do is create a demo, right? And try to show you how data moves from gathering of data to an actionable insight, right? And everything in between on Microsoft platform. So you can think of this as a reference architecture that most of the folks in the campaign ecosystem use and do. Now, in no way this actually has all the data, 290 million records, because it would be a lot of work to show that here. But what we have tried to do is create a sample water file, cleaned it, moved it using, and I'll have Ethan actually, I don't want to steal his thunder, but would walk it through the data movement, do some machine learning essentially, and see, you know, hey, you know, would this person be more, a propensity of vote, would this be more Republican or Democrat leaning, and then visualize that on Power BI. Ethan?
Great, thanks.
Take it away, man.
Thank you. So, political organizations have very similar data and analytics challenges that most organizations do. The primary difference is where the data comes from. Ashish mentioned a few times the voter file. For those that don't know what the voter file is, if you're a registered candidate or political organization, you can go to the state's Secretary of State office and say, give me a list of every registered voter. And generally speaking, most of the information on their driver's license, name, age, address, what county you're in, what city they're in. And you can begin to create and modify and add on to this voter file. That's a really valuable source of data if you're trying to do predictive analytics to target people, right? If you're trying to determine who's going to vote, who's likely to vote, who's likely to vote and lean left or lean right. It's good to get as much information about a person as you can. So that's a sort of a known way to get data. There are also lots of other sources as well, as you might imagine, right? Sometimes there's external data sources that you're maybe scraping from websites or that you're bringing in from news media organizations or from some of these polling and testing platforms, be it Microsoft Pulse or be it a more organized survey like Gartner might put out, or excuse me, not Gartner, Gannett. Also social media, rich source of information that campaigns will collect from. Also some of the own data that they create, like email messaging and email marketing. All of a sudden, you can send out an email to 9 million people and collect and look at who responds. So you're generating a lot of data with each email that you send and sort of gauging the response. That data is collected. That's a data collection process, and you have that stored somewhere, or maybe in multiple places, maybe in multiple formats. We want to consolidate that and store it and move it around to a place that makes sense and something that we can manage. Let's, for example, say SQL. So we can and we have helped. We've gone to many of our partners and our vendors and helped them set up Azure Data Factory, which is a service for, it's an ETL pipeline tool. You can collect data in Blob CSV over here, in SQL over here, in some sort of web scraping utility over here, move that all through the pipeline, standardize it, drop that in SQL. Great, it's in SQL. Now we want to do analytics on it. Sometimes these are small data sets, and sort of just SQL stored procedures will work just fine for your analytics. Sometimes these are really big data sets. Sometimes these are, you know, 350 million rows by 500 columns. That doesn't do so well to open that up in Excel, right? If you have a 60 terabyte voter file, you're not opening that up in Excel. You're not doing that on your desktop. We need a little bit more power, something like Hadoop using Polybase. Maybe we just want to ingest into machine learning and let it figure it out. Maybe we're using data lake analytics. And then, of course, once you've done your analysis, you need to make sense of it, be that visualizing in Power BI, creating smaller consumable Excel reports, or, as John's going to talk about a little bit later, using some APIs to get insight to your data and working with it on an individual level. So I'm going to leave PowerPoint here real quick and show you an example of a voter file. This is a sort of simplified, modified voter file with some of the information that you would expect. This one is anonymized, and actually none of these line up to anything real. But we have cities and states and race, age, et cetera. Let me clean up some of the noise here. So we have this basic demographic data in a voter file about a person that was provided perhaps in part by the Secretary of State, perhaps in part by external sources, and now we want to do something with that, right? So I've thrown this sample voter file into an Azure blob as a CSV exactly as it stands that you just saw here. And I'm going to open it up here, and we've set up a data factory instance to look at this. Data migrations in ETL does not a sexy demo make, but here it is. We have our blob source on the left. We have, it just went away. Blob source on the left. We have our data pipeline here that's moving it and dropping it into SQL. So what is it doing? The really great thing about Data Factory is you can get this graphical view. You can lay out steps that you want to process, and then you set up a schedule. Maybe you know you're getting new data every 30 days. You set this to run every 30 days on a schedule. You can come back and look at it and know that the data source that you're reading from is always fresh in SQL. So in this case, we're running a stored procedure to clean up our existing SQL table, and then we're copying the data over, right? We've done some very simple things at the source and the destination, like define what fields we want and what do those data types look like. We want this basic demographic data, age, race, gender, marital status, et cetera, moving that over. Pretty simple, but also really powerful. With tools like this, you can move terabytes of data in minutes. Which is really very helpful. You don't have to think about the scale with this, which is great. The same pipeline can exist if you want to bring in a list of volunteers that showed up to a rally in Florida. Maybe that's 100 people. Or maybe you want to get a new voter file dump that's 290 million. Set up the same pipeline, point it at two different data sources, let it run for you. Then once we have it in SQL, it's in a nice format that we know how to work with, and we want to maybe run some predictions on. Ashish, you want to about ML here?
This is the interesting part. All right. Okay, so once the data is sitting in SQL Server, what we want to do is we want to actually do a scoring model, and you can call it propensity to vote. Essentially, what we want to do is, based on some of the demographic information we have in the file, we want to predict that you would vote Republican or Democrat, right? So that's the idea of this model. Let me actually walk you through quickly this model and show you some data as well. Ooh, all right, sorry about that. I just have to figure out if I touch it or move it. Okay, here it is, now I get it. All right. So on the top, right, we have this import data. So as Ethan was saying, we move the data into SQL Server. Now what I'm doing is, I am actually loading it from a blob store, the same CSV that you saw. I want to actually import that data into ML workspace. If you look into this data quickly, this is how the data looks. And this is 250,000 rows, so obviously a sample that we wanted to show. 71 columns. Not every column is important for my prediction. So what I want to do is I want to actually make sure that I have select my features that would help me predict the party or propensity to vote. So what I do next is I actually would select some columns. And then I select another set of columns. And the reason I do it twice is because, out of 71 columns, I thought, there may be some which are very important, but I'm not sure, so let me just select them. But then for this model, I ended up selecting just 9 columns. So I think, based on these 9 columns, these features, I should be able to predict, your propensity to vote. Now, these names of these columns are kind of confusing. I don't even understand some of them. Well, they're easy, actually, but I'm lazy, right? So what I want to do is I then say, all right, I want to actually name them what I understand. So, you can in ML, you can do a lot of transformation in ML itself, right? So not only I want to clean the data, I can do cleaning of the data, but I can also edit metadata. What I mean by that is, now you see the names of the column, which are more kind of legible and understandable, right? And the way you do it is, if I select this, it's pretty easy. Let's see if I can. It's pretty easy. I can say, hey, select these columns and just name them new, right? So it just goes through that process. It renames them. And then I do a transformation. I said, there's a lot of people who have not told me in the data that they are Republican or Democrat. So for my training data, I want to actually have a label. And if there's an unknown label, which I label that I don't know, it's very hard for me to do this experiment. So I'm saying, just give me Republican Democrats out of this whole data set so that I can use that to train my model, right? And that's what it does. I also run an R script, and the reason for this R script is my data has more Democrats in it versus Republican. So because of that, my outcome would be more leaning towards the D side, right? Because the more data I have about Democrats, the model would score based on that, so my model would be skewed in the end. So what I'm trying to do is I'm saying, okay, randomly select equal number of D and R so that I can do training for this model, right? I do that. And then I also clean the data a bit, right? So cleaning some of the missing data, I'm saying, hey, income and age, there are some missing data, but then, if you find missing data, replace it with the median age or median income, right? Because I can see, that could be a better way to, rather than a missing data point, that could be a better way to add that missing data with a median data and then predict. With that, I actually do two models. One is two-class logistic regression and two-class decision forest. I split the data 80-20, and I do that, and then I score the model, and then we'll talk about that, right? So the idea is pretty simple. Again, I have a lot of data. I have a lot of columns. I want to actually select the right features for my prediction. I select them. I do some data manipulation in terms of, selecting the equal number of data points for both D and R, which I want to predict. I do some metadata editing. I fill missing data, and then I run this experiment. As I run this experiment, there are many algorithms that you can run this with, right? But I chose the logistic regression and the decision forest. And I think with 9 features, running a decision forest could give me good accuracy, right? And we can look into that too, right? Right, so I'm getting 64% accuracy, right? It's okay for me for this demo, all right? if I were a data scientist, I'll actually challenge this, but I'm fine now for this. Now, the last thing I did here is whatever I scored, I saved it as a data set, and I didn't have to do that. I can always expose this model as a web service or a batch service that can be consumed by my website or whatever tool I want. But I saved it as a data set so that Ethan can load that data set into Power BI and makes his demo simpler, right? So let's actually get back to Ethan, and let's see what he does with these scores.
Right on. So much more interesting than staring at, say, this. It's much more interesting to visualize this data and put it in the hands of a campaign or a campaign manager or a field organizer that can make sense of the data that we have, combined just the simple demographics, combined with maybe some predictions that we make, combined with the outcome of our ML model. So here's a very, this is a subset of this data. Obviously, it's all from Florida. And it's a 26,000 lines that came out of this ML model. Okay, what are we looking at here? This is an interesting way, something that a campaign manager might like to look at, or a field organizer. How many voters are in my state or in my area? How many of them vote often? How many voted in the last election cycle? How many of them are engaged enough to go vote in the primaries? Only 22%. It's actually, I think, higher than the national average, which is, in my mind, insane, but that's a different story. We can create some interesting maps and visuals in Power BI, and then we can really start to dig into some of this data, right? Propensity to vote by age group. Of those that are very likely to vote in Florida, unsurprisingly, they're in the 70 to 80 plus age group. No real surprise for Florida, but this validates maybe some of the assumptions that you've had. Who's likely to vote here? It seems that homeowners are twice as likely to vote as non-homeowners. They have a little bit more skin in the game, maybe. Also here, business owners. Business owners much more likely to vote than non-business owners. Again, we can use data to confirm maybe suspicions that we might have. Here's people that hold hunting licenses and what registered party they're a part of. Right? Not a big surprise, but it allows you to confirm that and target some of your messaging. You can also look at some of the demographics down here, breakdown of age and gender by party, and you can maybe start to see and filter down and create some more complex visuals and algorithms to say, you know, maybe we're lagging in this particular group. We should visualize that. And then down here, these bottom two charts are the direct output of the ML model that we just had, which is some simple stats here to say age and education level and their likelihood to lean left or right. And it shouldn't surprise anyone that the younger demographic, the 20 to 30, leans left, and some of that older demographic, 60 to 70, for example, in this case, leans right. This would, I think, be confirmed generally across the state of Florida, but our predictions are here, and we can start to use those and mold those into decisions that a campaign would make.
So, if you look in the left, right, which is what Ethan was saying, under 20, and as you go, as long as you're under 40, based on this ML model, based on the age feature, it is predicting that if you're under 40, you will lean Democrat, but as you start getting into that middle age, like me, right, you start leaning towards Republican. So the ML model actually, based on that feature of age, scored, right, that was one of the features and scored, and then, that's what is scoring, either you're Republican or Democrat, and that's what this visual shows.
Great. In the interest of time, we should probably press on here, I guess.
Yes.
So there's lots of interesting visuals to look at. We will be around afterwards. We've mentioned this multiple times throughout this presentation. The work that Microsoft is doing in the campaigns is not our work alone. We wouldn't be here without the vendors and the partners that are embracing and adapting our technology and really helping us drive it in the ecosystem. So we have a quick 2-minute video, and then you'll actually hear from some of our partners that are in the room with us today.
Super Tuesday is a day where there are primary or caucuses where candidates are vying for presidential nomination.
Primaries are a big stepping off point for campaigns. We don't really take part, but we always keep an eye on what's going on.
Everything a campaign does is generating data.
If you don't have the strongest grasp on that data, you are sticking your finger in the wind, hoping and praying for the best.
Technology has become the backbone of data analytics, which is really what the modern campaign is all about.
Our team lies underneath the civic and tech engagement part of Microsoft.
We engage with the partners and help them build solutions on our platform.
We needed better reports, and we needed a way to visualize our data in a simplified manner.
We landed on Microsoft Power BI to help us display all of our information.
And I think it's going to revolutionize our reporting and dashboarding.
At the DNC, we have a tool called LBJ that helps us assign our volunteers to polling locations, record incidents.
The DNC uses Microsoft Dynamics to quickly spin up something that can be very useful and effective in the field.
Campaigns tend to be very spiky in terms of their activity, and that's a really good use case for using Azure to scale that up very quickly.
As well as improve reliability for our clients, it's running in Azure. We have a backup. We're good to go.
Microsoft realized that they needed to go to the people on the campaigns who would help implement the technology that they were talking about envisioning.
We have few programs where we engage with the partners early on. We call it private previews. They can access the technology which is not yet in market.
Campaign Command Center lets us communicate in practically real time. They don't want to hear about statistical regression models that we build. They just want to know what's happening and what can we do in order to improve it.
Microsoft has a very strong commitment to corporate citizenship.
We want to ensure that elections are open and fair and accessible.
Our goal should be to empower everyone, not only the people who are running for office, but the people who want to participate in the process.
All right, so hey, my name's James McAuliffe. I work with Convergence Consulting Systems in Tampa, Florida, Convergence Consulting Group. I'm a BI solution architect, and what we do is business intelligence. That's all we do. And we worked with the RNC this year. We partnered with the RNC and Microsoft to modernize their data platform and to increase their ability to move a lot of data faster and to get insights from it. We worked with them in 2012 we created a fast track data warehouse. I don't know if you know about that, the reference architecture. We did about 4 terabytes of voter analytics data. And so this year they had us come back and do more comprehensive re-architecture of their systems to bring it along and bring it into modernization, because this is kind of what it looks like. So this story really is a story about speed to value and overcoming technical hurdles, overcoming the inability to move quickly into new technologies. This year, the RNC went from the basement to the cloud, and physically went from the basement to the cloud. We implemented brand new technologies with ease. We implemented SQL Server 2016 technologies, and there were no surprises in there. So this story is really about spending more time extracting meaning from the data and less time wrangling with it. So what you're seeing here is the wrangling issue. So RNC, they probably told you, like you heard earlier about the whole volunteer thing, every 4 years, this business, the RNC business, they lose 75% of their workforce. They go away. Here's the election. Everything's crazy, crazy, crazy. The election occurs, the event occurs. Boom, everybody goes away. 3 years later, a whole new crew comes in. They don't know anything about what happened before. And so what it starts looking like is this. So everybody goes and gets their own data any way they can. These people come in and they're super passionate, super motivated, super smart, but what they don't know is where to get the data. They really pretty much have all the same questions. What they want to know is what you saw earlier through machine learning, what the questions that people are asking and what they want to know from the data is, who are you, voter? Who are you? What do you look like? The next question they want to know is, are you going to vote? Because if you're going to vote, I'm interested in you. If you're not going to vote, I can't spend time working with you. The third thing they want to know is, what do you care about? What are the issues that are important to you? Because if the issues that you care about, I want to message that. Like you saw earlier about the gun owners and the hunters, that's a certain kind of messaging that you want to get out, right? So, and then the fourth thing they want to do is they want to know, can I persuade you to vote for my candidate? So all these new people come in at the beginning of the cycle. They know nothing about what the data is. And so what they spend their time, the questions they really end up asking are, where is the data? And so every time they ask that question, they get a different answer. Some person says, it's over here in that database. Oh, it's over here in that database. Oh, it's there. We have that piece of data on AWS in MySQL. Oh, it's over here in my Excel spreadsheet, or it's over here in my little database. So these types of people, they spend most of their time saying, where is the data? How can I get to it? What do I have to do to it to make meaning out of it? And how can I finally extract what I need to do to conduct my business? So you see, most of the time they're spending In this kind of environment, this is my data flow architecture. This is what it looks like. And so what we ended up doing was working on that. So the ask was, so the RNC brought us in and they said, okay, we cannot continue doing this. This isn't working very well for us. So we have to modernize. We think it's going to be hard to get through this cycle doing the same things we've been doing in the past, getting on that speeding train, the tyranny of the urgent. So they came to us about a year and a half ago and they said, we need to modernize. We need your help with that. So what they have in terms of this data that they're looking at, they have voluminous amounts of data. 300 terabytes of voter file data that they've stored. That is their active production data. Beyond that, they have petabytes of data that they use for enhancement or enrichment and also archiving going back years and years and years. And they were storing that all on premise in this aging infrastructure, physically down in the basement, and it was not serving their needs anymore. That is a lot of data. And so they said to us, okay, well, we want to move this into Azure. And I said, well, that is a lot of data to move into Azure. And they said, we also need it to support our existing voter file processing. When we ingest a voter file and we bring it through, like you saw earlier, bring a voter file in, they were kind of being kind. So there's 50 states that give data to the system, 50 states, 50 different voter files, different from month to month, different every time you look at them. So they say we need to stay with our existing process. We don't have the time to change what we're doing because, again, we're only a year and a half out from the election, and like Ashish said earlier, that date is not going to slip. So what we did, we moved everything up into Azure. And I got to say, it's hard for me to properly convey how much we got done in a short time, but I'm going to try. For those who wonder whether this approach is truly scalable and whether it could work for you, I was telling these guys earlier today, looking back, I had no idea that we actually got done what we got done. We took all voter file ingestion and moved it to the cloud. The entire process starts in the cloud in Azure. We took all the legacy processing, including some non-Microsoft data quality and data enrichment process software that we moved, we did a physical to virtual migration of that. We moved that up to the cloud. Total processing time for that file ingestion to the reporting capability dropped just by moving the architecture, dropped from, for large states, it was taking 2 to 3 days to get through it, and now it was taking 2 to 3 hours to process a state like California or New York or Florida, some of the bigger states. So that was a huge, we didn't change anything about the process, we just moved it into a more modern architecture. So we're also implemented in the process SQL 2016 Polybase so they can do some interesting analytics and get some deep voter analytics out of it as the data follows through. And on our reporting database, our dimensional data store, we ended up with 30 terabytes of final reporting data, as you can see in the middle, 30 terabytes. And to that, we attached tabular analysis services for our semantic layer, Power BI for the final data consumers, also supporting ad hoc usage and for prepared presentation layers. So what they can do now, so notice that this looks like, this may look to you like a typical data warehouse implementation, but what it really is a replatforming into a modern fabric architecture where now everything's in Azure. All those tool sets you saw that they're implementing, we can easily attach into this whole process. So any kind of expansion or flexibility can easily be added. So what they can do now, national and state level reporting for 200 million voters is at their fingertips in Power BI. There's no limitations on what they can do. The vote history analytics with billions of rows of data are being processed real time as they go through it so they can see the results of that. Voter contact survey and disposition data to understand the voters' mindsets, near real-time updates every 30 minutes. Early voting analysis for key states. Again, real-time updates every 30 minutes. Vote propensity and persuasion analytics reporting. They have that in Power BI. They have scoring mechanisms in billions of rows that are coming up with those conclusions that they're using in the background. So from my point of view, taking where they were from that aging infrastructure in the basement and getting it into the cloud, 9 months, that's a tremendous success story. And we actually left, and RNC continues to improve this. We're not there anymore. Convergence Consulting has left. RNC has taken over ownership of this and continues to improve it and continues to put in new technologies and new reporting capabilities every day. So I think it's a great success story, and I think it's a great example of a truly modern data warehouse implementation easily implemented using Azure technologies. So thanks.
Thanks, Shane.
Yep. Hey. All right, so my name is John Lee. I'm the CTO of NGP Van. So what is NGP Van? Admittedly, we have kind of a weird alphabet soup sort of name, so I'll do a brief description. Well, it says right here that we are the largest provider of technology for Democrats and their allies. I was kind of thinking about how to present it, and I think, you know, one way to think about it for this audience is we're kind of like the Office 365 for political campaigns. So if you're a office that is serious about productivity, you're going to be using Office 365. If you're a campaign on the Democratic side of the ticket that is serious about winning, you use our tools at NGP Van. Is the next slide actually in there? Yeah, so to break it down sort of what we do, we provide three services. So voter contact, that's your door-to-door knocking program. We have a, you know, a mobile application that allows campaigns to talk to voters at the door, phone banking, and sort of the traditional type of campaign contact. Behind all of that is sort of the infrastructure for the voter file that you guys have described. And for a variety of historical reasons, the Democratic National Committee, who we work with, and us as the vendor have sort of provided the base infrastructure that that James described, sort of that is the analog on the RNC side. We also provide a variety of tools for fundraising, so that's obviously, you know, raising money and then filing reports on that money, so that that you know that you're compliant with FEC rules. And then on the digital side, that's sort of your traditional you know, digital property. So that would be your candidate website, your contribution pages. We also provide a variety of tools that are a little cooler than that. So digital advertising, targeted digital advertising, and things of the like. So we work with campaigns sort of all the way up and down the ticket. When we say we're the largest infrastructural provider, through the DNC, we basically work with almost every Democratic campaign that runs in the country. That's, you know, from the smallest legislative races to congressional races to statewides, all the way to the presidential races. And we were lucky enough to work with the 2008 and 2012 Obama campaigns, and we're really happy to work with Hillary for America this year. Cool. So what did we do with Microsoft? we did a lot of stuff. So if we go to the next slide. You know, first I should thank Ashish and Ethan and everybody else at the Microsoft team. They really provided us with a lot of guidance and support. And some of the work that we did was actually infrastructural, some of the stuff that James talked about. We were also able to move some of our core backend workflows onto Azure for scalability and elasticity. But we also actually built some of our newest digital tools directly on top of Azure services. So the one that I'm going to highlight here today is called Best Ask. So what is Best Ask? The idea is pretty simple. So we want to provide customized ask amounts for the individual. So if you come to a donation page that's hosted by us, because we work with a congressional candidate, let's say, we want to ask you the amount that's customized for you rather than a generic dollar ask amount, right? Ideally, we want to ask you for the sweet spot in terms of the amount of money that you're willing to donate. So how do we do this? Well, we actually leveraged an existing feature that we have called Action Profile. So, you know, it's a branded name for basically a cookie that pre-fills forms across our client network. So let's say we have a client that's a state legislator, and you go to their website, and you filled out a form to volunteer and to donate. That will get saved in a cookie, and then later you come to a Democratic congressional website, and you want to volunteer there. The form is pre-filled through our network. Obviously, we work for just Democrats, so that works. And we've seen this to be sort of a tremendous feature for our clients. We've seen conversions go from 3% on forms to 10% to all the way up to 15%. So this is a huge sort of get in terms of conversions. But then what we did was we took all of that data and we fed it into Cortana. So more specifically, the cognitive services API, the recommendation API. And to get in the weeds a little bit, the feature that we used was the user to item recommendation. So we were able to take sort of users, which are basically donors that are coming to your website, and items, which are these distinct donation buckets and ask amounts, and use that algorithm that was baked into the cognitive services in order to ask for the right recommendation. So this is an animated GIF, right? So you can kind of see, you know, somebody coming in without an action profile would see $20 donation, something more standard. But you can see that if it knows that it's me based on the cookie technology, and it says you're John Lee, then it's going to ask me for a little bit more money, because based on my past donation history, they know that that's the right ask amount. So what's next? There's a variety of really cool things that we can do. I mean, obviously, Cortana makes it really easy to ask these questions, right? Some of the ML stuff that they showed here, we actually explored that option, but the recommendation API here just ended up giving us really great results without having to do all of the back-end gymnastics of creating our own algorithms, although that's really awesome that we can do that. We can ask more detailed questions about this, fundraising world. How much money are we going to raise? What's the right ask amount to maximize a donation for the entire cycle, right? There are limits in terms of how much people can donate. But we're also looking at sort of applying this to the other parts of our business. So, as an example, we have phone banking technology that a lot of the volunteers use to call voters. It's quite possible for us to plug that into the Cortana API, make sure that those conversations are affected by giving recommendations to people about what kind of conversations to have, what kind of topics this voter would be receptive to. That's the kind of work that's already happening at the presidential level, where a lot of data scientists are creating these models to separate the universes and who you're talking to. But something like Cortana, something like these cognitive services would allow us to commoditize that and really help us do this at the local level, have congressional candidates and state legislative candidates be able to leverage sort of the insight that's provided by machine learning and AI. So that's it, and thank you for inviting me to talk here today.
Of course, thanks, Sean.
Cool.
So, thank you everyone for attending our talk today. I hope that everybody found this interesting. I hope that everybody learned something new while they were here today. We're not quite at the end of our time yet. There are mics scattered throughout the room. We'd be happy to take questions that anybody has. You can address them to us, you can address it to them, any of the above, but happy to answer some questions.
So normally when you're building models, you wanna test the data with actual results so you can verify your results, but we have a secret ballot system in the US, so how do you sort of really estimate if your predictive voting pattern is accurate or not?
Yeah, so what you're saying is how are you labeling the data, right? So what you saw was the label was provided in the voter file by self-identification. So hey, I'm a Republican. So when I go and fill, I can identify myself as a Republican or a Democrat or undecided or whatever, right? So it's the label is not the outcome of actually what I voted, but what I told that I'm aligned to this party versus the other. Right, that's what the label was,
and you can extend that to getting attributes from things like exit polling.
Yeah, and exactly.
Right, there are lots of other means in which people self-identify, but obviously it's a secret ballot, and you have no way of verifying. That's sort of the big joke of all of this modeling is that you never know if you're right unless someone tells you, and you rely on the sparse data sources that you have to tell you that. Otherwise, you try to back out of aggregate statistics for a county, for a state, for a city.
Yes. Kind of along those same lines, when you were going through some of the demographic data, many of the things you pointed out, you said this kind of validates what you would expect, right? Were there any surprises as you went through the data with this cycle? Was there anything that popped in that maybe that you didn't expect that the data turned up for you?
Well, it also depends. So I'll give you this example. When we had two models, one was logistic regression, the other was a decision tree forest. And earlier today, in fact, Ethan and I were looking at the model, and what logistic regression was providing us actually raised our eyebrows, because what it was telling us was not what you saw on the screen. So again, it depends on the model, and that's why ML provides you different testing, different algorithms, right? And see, hey, which one makes sense. The thing with the logistic regression, which actually caught our eyeballs, was that we looked at the data, and there were a lot more people were the scoring was skewed towards Democrats, right? Looking at the same data versus the other model actually looked, you know, from an aging perspective, when we looked at that visualization, that looked more correct to us, right? So again, data science is not just about technology. It's so much about a data scientist as well, or the domain expert that will look in the data and say, hey, something doesn't see right, or something is wrong. And that's what we were able to actually observe, and then decided that we will actually create a visualization on the decision tree versus the logistic regression.
Let me also add on to that and give us maybe a more real-world observed example of when we made a data model and then looked at what happened versus our model. And this isn't just us. This is, I think, a lot of people. Try to say this in the right way. The candidates that are currently on the ballot, I think, are an anomaly. I don't think that people, the best data scientists, were predicting when there were 16 candidates on this side and four on this side. I don't think a lot of models would have predicted that it would have been Clinton versus Trump on the ballot. So that's right. That's one example of, hey, this looks right, and then you try it in reality, and it's different than what you thought it would be.
Okay. No. Sorry.
Yes.
I as a relative novice to Azure ML, this is the first time I've actually seen you using two models at the same time, two algorithms in the same model.
Yeah.
So my first question is, what influenced you in choosing those two models?
I'm sorry, what?
What influenced you in choosing those two algorithms, by the way?
Right, so, regression, you know, it's a classification problem, right, where we are saying, you know, either one versus the other. So it's a two-class classification problem. Decision tree, you understand that, you know, hey, decision tree is more or less a classification tool. Logistic regression is as well. So the best approach that I have seen is you come up with a notion, hey, these are the models that would work best for this data, and then you start using ML tools to play with those models, right? So what made me choose is because I thought it would be very quick to actually use logistic regression and decision tree to do this.
But
the benefit that you get from this tool is you can use a lot of algorithms and compare them side by side as you're looking at the data.
Is that apparent in the model, because you have two algorithms and then you scored it?
Yeah. You can do as many if you want, right? Okay. Essentially, what you do is you split the data. Now, I have 80-20. I want the 80 is my training data set. I want that 80% to run through three models, and then I evaluate all these three models, and I score them against each other. I score them and then evaluate against each other and see which actually gives me better result. And then, you know, there are things like confusion matrix and area under the curve and all that to figure out, you know, which model works better. Right?
Great, yeah. Repping the Gary Johnson t-shirt over here.
Well, so anyway, not to, you know, be completely biased there. Your data model, most data people want to have a complete picture. Your data model is restricting to two sides.
Right.
So how as data people do you feel about not having the complete model, and has the missing data had any effect, especially in this election that's been so up in the air, as you said?
Right. So that's purely a result of what we put together for this demo. In any real-world scenario, of course, you would consider many more than five factors, and you would include all of the various parties. But we just intentionally, to make the visualization simpler, to make the demo easier, we just split into DNR. That we just made a choice to do that for this demo. But in any real-world model, you would have a lot more complexity.
Well, since it sounded like you'd done a lot of real-world, specifically with the parties that are paying you to assist with doing their data models. That's the, you know, it goes along with the demo. But I was still curious if on the back end, maybe you guys had tinkered with it or anything of the sort.
We do have some data scientists that have actually worked with this data and tinkered with it. And one of them, if you want to follow, his name is David Rothschilds, and he actually does publish, I think, New York Times or New York Post or somewhere. Yeah. But he has his own blog, and he does actually, he's Microsoft Research who plays with the data and does some predictions. So if you want to follow that real world scenario, yeah, he's a good guy to follow on Twitter as well as to look into his blog post. Excellent.
Yeah. Thank you, guys.
Yeah. Thanks. Any other questions? All right. Well, thank you so much for coming.
Thanks a lot.
We'll be up here if you have more questions, but thanks, everyone.